or you can get a bite from outside from the bite stands, and just make sure it gets returned safely to the place where you took it from. The bike should be set up before the lesson starts, and you want to set it in a place where it's visible to all of the students. So in the center of the room, in the front of the room, you could have, if you're really lucky, you could have one bike in the back and one in the front. But make sure that everybody has a good view of the bike, because everybody will need to see it. But they don't all need to see the front of it. They need to see different angles. So these three girls all have a different perspective on the bike. She might even scoot over and skip the bike from this side, just for something different. So have that set up ready to go. All the students should have pencils from their own desks. So we will start by taking your... Well, actually, let's first look at the bike, and then we'll take our viewfinders, and we'll start looking at it more closely. So we're looking at the bike. Okay, look carefully. What kind of angles do you see? Do you see sharp lines, or do you see wiggly lines? What kind of shapes do you see in the bike?
Obtuse angles on the front.
Good. Obtuse angles. What else?
Straight lines.
Straight lines. Do you see any circles?
Not very many.
The tires are circular. No. From this side, I can see the gear, the chain, gear shifting thing is circular. There are lots of circular patterns. If you look carefully, there are circles, there are screws and bolts. The handlebars end in circles. If you look at the patterns on the bike itself, you can see that on the tires, there are little, it's a repeating pattern. It's some kind of a pentagon, but it's an interesting shape. And remember, we're zooming in on this. We're looking at a small piece of the bike, not the whole bike. So if you look at these smaller patterns, the pattern of the reflectors is really cool, honeycomb pattern. I'll turn that so you guys can see it when you're sketching. There are little circles on the kickstand. Up here we have diamond shapes on the handlebars. The seat has diamonds. I don't know if you guys can see that from your angle, but it has a diamond pattern. The front tires have stripes, and so if you're looking carefully, you'll see there are lots of different patterns to play around with. On this side, for the students over here, there's the chain, which is a really cool piece of the bike to work with. The front of the bike, you'll have students who can see, who are seated up in the front, and you can see the shaft of the handlebars coming down. The colors of the bike are irrelevant, actually, for this project. It's the shapes that we want to really focus on. There are a lot of shapes, and it's important to focus on that so the kids don't get overwhelmed by, I can't draw a bike. The point isn't that you draw a bike today. The point is that you draw a very small section, and the very small section might just be made of a half of a circle and some angular lines. So if you really take it down to a smaller level, it's a far less overwhelming project. So, everybody should have a viewfinder. This is in the supply box. The supply box. They're little viewfinders. I'll give you yours in a minute, Katrina. The viewfinders are, you know, you'll sometimes see a photographer or an artist set up to take a picture by doing this, right? Kind of checking out the angles, right? Perfect. The viewfinder is to allow you to do that. So if you put the viewfinder right up to your eye, you can see the whole bike. So you don't want to do that. Hold it off a little ways, maybe close one eye so that you can really focus through the one, and you'll kind of shift it around. Right now I'm seeing where the front tire meets the post up to the handlebars. So right now I'm looking at just this square. So what I want you to do is use your viewfinders to just examine the bike. You want to stand up over here or scoot to the side. You want to do it in the corner, you can. So by using viewfinders, you take this big bike and you bring it down. And you can look at the designs that are incorporated on the bike and focus on them without the distraction of the whole bike or your classmates or whatever else is in the room. In the supply kit, in the supply box, we have some samples that you will have on your board. We don't have them with us today because we're off campus. But there are samples of previous bicycle art projects that you can have hung on the board, and samples of some of the textures and designs you might have perpendicular lines there. So vertical and horizontal. Your papers, yeah, I got it backwards. The papers for the bicycle artwork can be held vertically or horizontally. When they do their final art project, they can. The paper does not have to go upright. A lot of our sample art shows vertical layout, but that's not how you have to do your art. Okay? You go with what feels right for what you are sketching. Okay, next rule. The drawing must touch all four sides of the paper. We don't want a big piece of paper with a tiny bicycle in the middle that you can see the whole bike. That's not what we're doing today. Today we are doing an enlargement. So you have a big piece of paper, and on our lesson sheet, it actually says the paper we're going to be using is, let's see, it says it's a 12-inch by 18-inch sulfite drawing paper. That's a big piece of paper. They used to be even bigger, but the teachers said they were just too hard for the kids to manage on their desks and to display on the wall. So 12 by 18, thank you, very nice. Okay, so it's going to look like this. Instead of a bicycle in the middle of the page, or even a bicycle like this, we want to have a picture. Can't you tell us a bicycle?
Yeah.
That looks like this. Okay? You're going to really zoom in. That's a tire. And it will be in far more detail because when you take it down to that scale, you can get a lot of the small details. Okay, so touching all four sides, or maybe three. This side I wasn't quite touching, but it's close enough. It's artistically set to the side. So you'll have to go around and help the kids remember these rules. Okay, the last rule is it should have details. Details like nuts, bolts, these are portions of mechanics of a bike, stickers or tape that's wrapped around the handlebars. You should have the reflectors. You should have details, okay? Some of the details, like this little ripped off sticker, maybe you want to skip that one. But other details, like these pieces of the bike, are valuable. And in fact, this silly old bike is kind of good because we don't get distracted by too many logos. But if the bike has logos, the kids can focus on the logos. That's okay. I think focusing on the mechanics of the bike is a little bit more artistically beautiful. But that's just me. So make sure you have details. And again, the art docent or the assistant docents need to go around and remind those kids to focus on the details. I'm going to have these guys do really quick pencil sketches. I might interrupt them before they're done. But what I'd like you to do is fold your newsprint, and this is how the kids in the classrooms will do it. Fold your newsprint into fourths. So you fold it once into quadrants, not triangles, okay? Once down the middle in half, and again, down with the other middle in half, so you'll have quadrants. And then in each quadrant, have them do a very quick sketch of a part of the bike. So, let's see, I guess I'll do it from the single. You guys can go ahead and get started, and you will just say, okay, use your viewfinders. If you want to use your viewfinders to help you really focus on a small part, don't worry about the details. These are not finished products. This is just saying what part of the bike interests me the most. Okay? Okay, so in each section, the kids will have made a quick pencil sketch of some section of the bike, remembering these rules that they're going to incorporate diagonal, curved, vertical, horizontal lines. It will be touching all four sides, even in these small papers, it should touch all four sides of their quadrants, and they're going to focus on details like nuts and bolts and stickers and tape and spokes and screws and whatever little details they notice. So what I'd like you girls to do is hold it up for the camera for just a moment. Very good. I know you haven't finished. I haven't given you enough time. In the lesson plan, it says 16 minutes approximately, so it helps you know how long is spent. Thank you. So the next step is to do enlarging. And this will be the bulk of your class time. Now, a great technique for doing enlarging is to use this folding that we already did. So they'll give you an original picture and they'll say, now make a duplicate, make a copy. And so they'll have the original picture in a box like this, and then they'll have another picture, or they'll have another page next to it with smaller boxes. And what they'll say is, if you're trying to sketch this fancy thing, then break it down and say, what is in this quadrant? And all it is a line. And what is in this quadrant? And it's a line that starts to go up. So you'll take your paper and you'll create quadrants. Not that many, obviously. So pick out of your four sketches, your four quick sketches, which one you think you want to run with, which one you want to do your final draft. Just a second. Fold your paper so only that quadrant is visible. Fold, so only your favorite is visible. Okay, so I've got mine, so my favorite is showing. Okay, it should be very small at this point. You can set aside your viewfinders. Cool, I like how she's got these, where the spokes attach, she's focused on the details and shown how the spokes aren't just straight lines going into the bike, but they have little wider tips that secure them. And I can see on Audrey's that she's focused on the three little circles that allow for you to adjust the height of your front tire. And that's a good detail. And Katrina has, it looks like she was starting to get, is that chain?
Yeah.
So she, I rushed her, but she was starting to incorporate some of the chain into her tire she was sketching. So it looks like we're going to see a lot of wheels, which is okay. That's an interesting part of the bike. One of the tricky parts with the wheels is the spokes. And we tend to get super excited and draw millions of them. And there aren't really that many. So when you use your viewfinder as you're doing your final sketch, you want to focus on and carefully count how many spokes are in your viewfinder. Okay? That's it. Because it's the kids get carried away. Spokes are fun. Okay, so now that you have this folded, you're going to fold it some more. Fold this in half. And again in half, so you have four quadrants. Okay, and this I'll clip up here so I can keep it visible, and these girls will have theirs next to their paper. And then what you'll do with your paper, may I borrow this one? They'll fold their paper down the center just gently. They might not fold the whole way. They might just pinch the corners to show that's the center line. And then they'll fold it again vertically and kind of pinch the ends. And that will help them know that's the center line there. And then with their pencils and the rulers that have been provided, they'll, I stole your ruler, they'll do a quick line. It's very light. Make sure that you remind these kids to do a very light line to indicate where these quadrants are. So once you have your large paper in quadrants, just like your small paper, you can just look at each of the little quadrants on its own. And it's a technique for enlarging. So we're going to give them a minute to do that, the quadrants. Okay, while they do that, a few tools that are included in our docent bin are rulers. Actually, we have stored above it, we have yardsticks, which are good because the papers are too big at certain angles for a 12-inch ruler. So in the bin, there are yardsticks so that the kids who want to do a full line all the way across the big pieces of paper can do that. Otherwise, rulers are good. And there's also, so that's obviously for straight lines, you'll also find kind of an interesting thing, which is a bunch of pencils with string attached to them. And this is what allows us to do, it's like a compass. Oops, we're using the side of paper. So you could say, if I'm incorporating the bottom part of the tire, I want it to really be, I want to reflect where the middle of the tire really would be. And so it looks like I'm going to be working horizontally. So the middle of my tire is actually off the page. What I would do is put my finger on the paper right off the edge of the page and say, oops, this is going to be tricky. I need to get a nice circle, so I use it like a compass and swing it around, and that allows me to have a really nice line. That's a little higher than I intended, so I'll make that the inside circle of my bike, and then I'll do another line further down. That'll be the outside part of the tire. That still is probably too adult-sized tire. So I, what I probably did, and what you can help the kids understand, because it's a new, this is probably a new tool, is that if you're going to try and replicate a tire this big, you're going to have to put your center, this is radius, good math word, yeah. They'll try and really reflect the true radius of the bike tire. And I think, actually, this should be tied down at the bottom there. So it would be more like this. So you'd say if the radius of the bike is only 4 or 5 inches, then just give yourself that much room, and you'll get a much more accurate bike tire size. Okay? So with that, I'm going to let you guys take a minute to look at your quadrants, figure out what you're going to do where. If anybody wants to use the compass to draw, you may. And I'll just let them work. And while they work, because we're doing a really super speed version of the lesson, I'll give a few more pointers, and then I'll interrupt them before they finish to give the next step in the lesson. So what they're doing now is they've got the quadrants, they've outlined very lightly. Please help the kids remember to do very light outlines. You guys can ignore me for now. So that the pencil marks showing the quadrants don't end up overwhelming their art. And then they're transferring their design from the small sketch onto the large paper. And if they work one section at a time in pencil, they won't, they'll be able to really do a good job of enlarging it. If you don't have them break it down into these quadrants, then you'll end up with a lot more frustration with the kids, because it's easy to get it wrong if they try to fill this huge piece of paper completely freehand. So breaking it down into smaller sections will allow them to feel more success with their final product. Let's see, what else? The wheels and the spokes. So we already talked about using the compass. Remember that spokes come from the center. They radiate from the center. So if your center is off your page, if you use the compass, and you guys can listen to this part, if you used the compass to create the tire and the compass was the center off the page like mine was, then you should remember when you're doing your spokes that they're also going to be starting up here. Okay? Oh, this is stressful. So you'll have your lines coming down all the way from off the page so that you won't have spokes all starting at the top of the page, but they'll be coming from off the page. They won't meet in the middle. Okay? Does that make sense to you guys? Okay. It's important that you line them up. I've seen lots of art where they just can't get the fact that it's off the page. And one way to avoid that is to say, well, if you're struggling with that, then maybe make your tire have its radius on the page. Audrey's, I'm going to just hold up for a minute. Audrey's center for tire is in the center of the page. So she will know exactly where to start the spokes from. Emma has chosen a different challenge. And so she's got, I'm going to show this, she's got the center of her tire off the center of the page, or at least off-centered. So she's going to have a little bit more of a struggle to try and get the spokes to reflect where they're radiating from, where they're coming from. Okay, so there's that pointer. Once they've done their pencil drawing, and they should take time with it. This is a good 30, 40, 45 minutes of work that they'll be doing. And, you know, you'll have some kids who are going really fast, and you can encourage them to slow down, focus on the details. And you'll have some kids go very slowly, and so you'll have to kind of help them move along by giving them some time warning. Say, right now you should be about halfway done. But when they've kind of enlarged correctly, you'll bring around the markers, the permanent markers, the Sharpies that are in the bin. And at that point, after they've enlarged it correctly, they will trace over it with a black Sharpie, which makes it permanent. So I'll give that back to you. So once they trace their final enlargement, then they get to use the pencils and the markers. And with those, they can add whatever color always add their name to either the back or the corner of this room. It won't detract from the picture. Because this is kind of an industrial type of piece of artwork, maybe it will look better to have their name on the back rather than the impressionistic pieces that they've done at other times. So they may want to keep it more industrial looking by just keeping it a